What's new?
Where's the doctor?
Good morning, church.
Good morning.
As I look to the camera, I'm not sure who, if anybody, is able to be watching us right at the moment. We did have some technical problems connecting with YouTube, so we're trying to use Facebook to come on. So hopefully you've connected with us that way, and if not, you may be watching this later on YouTube as a video. So again, I apologize if that's been an issue for anyone this morning. Do have some announcements that we do want to share as we begin the service. The Monday morning check-in is going to be postponed for a couple of weeks. And we'll be picking it up again on Monday, October 26th. So again, if you're part of our check-in group, you can check in, but there's no one to check in with. So we'll be seeing you again on the 26th. This Wednesday's discussion group is also postponed because, as we do that with Asbury United Methodist Church, their church conference is this Wednesday night. So the folks that normally would be part of that will be at the conference. So we'll be postponing that for a week as well. But our men's group will continue to go on. And if you're looking for something to do at the end of the week, then come on down to the church where the basket extravaganza is taking place. Was really glad to see that it made the front page of the Palmyra Sun this past week. So they have over 40 baskets of all different kinds of varieties, depending on your interests, that you can come, get your tickets, and make your bids. So again, we hope you'll come Thursday. I believe the times are in the bulletin. We've also sent them out. Let me look real fast. Thursday and Friday, it's 12 to 8, Saturday, 10 to 4, and Sunday, 11 to 1. So again, we hope you'll come down and support them in all that they do. Also coming up on November 1st, which is in fact a Sunday, it's our All Saints Day. And we realize that it will be a little different this year because of the virus. But we're still gonna do one important thing, which is to remember those who have passed, the saints that have gone to be with God. And we are going to be lighting candles for those certainly who have passed this past year. But in addition, if there's someone you want to remember, that normally during the service people come up and will light a candle for a loved one that's gone, please send that name to the church office, either call, leave a message, or email us, and we will take, and as part of that service, we will be lighting candles and saying their names. So if there's someone you want to remember, just get that to the church office, and we will have the candles here to light to remember them as part of that special service. So we give thanks for those that are here, for those who have tracked us down online. And we take, and as we've started as a tradition, we take a moment and start worship by lighting a candle to take and remind us of the light of Christ and that of the Holy Spirit. And if you're at home, we invite you to light your candle as well, that the light goes from soul to soul, spirit to spirit. So we welcome you into this time of worship. And let's begin with the call to worship. Come and worship, all you who love and serve God, who surrounds us with unfailing love and answers us when we call, who cares for the humble and lowly and never abandons those in need.
This is our God, worthy of our worship and praise.
We're going to sing Christ for the Lord We Sing. We'll sing verses 1, 2, and 4.
Join me in the opening prayer. O God, who never changes, we come before you on this day to seek the change that only you can bring to our wounded hearts and broken spirits. From the bumps and bruises we receive through daily living, we come to this place and time to be transformed, cleansed, and healed. O Lord, who has and is to come, give us faith to become more fully the reflections of your love you have called us to become. Breathe on us the breath of transforming life, the Holy Spirit of Christ Jesus. We gather in anticipation of your work in our lives. Amen. Today is from the book of Luke, chapter 19, verses 1 through 10. Jesus entered Jericho and was passing through. A man was there by the name of Zacchaeus. He was the chief tax collector and climbed a sycamore, and he was wealthy, He wanted to see who Jesus was, but because he was short, he could not see over the crowd. So he ran ahead and climbed a sycamore fig tree to see him, since Jesus was coming that way. When Jesus reached the spot, he looked up and said to him, "Zacchaeus, come down immediately. I must stay at your house today." So he came down at once and welcomed him gladly. All the people saw this and they began to mutter, "He has gone to be the guest of a sinner." But Zacchaeus stood up and said to the Lord, "Look, Lord, here and now I give half of my possessions to the poor, and if I have cheated anybody out of anything, I will pay back four times the amount." And Jesus said to him, "Today salvation has come to this house, because this man too is a son of Abraham, for the Son of Man came to seek and to save the lost." So ends this reading.
Most of us might have sung once in a while when we were little kids. I kind of looked over and Sandy was singing along. So she's probably led some of our vacation Bible school kids with that song from time to time. I just thought it was something cute to start with. And I started, as I thought about that and being a kid, I thought about some of the games I used to play as a kid. I'm not sure any of these games, to some extent, kids play anymore. In our neighborhood, we used to jump on our bikes, and we'd pick three kids to go off, and then the rest of us would try to find them. And it was our game of cops and robbers. We used to go out in the woods and play cowboys and Indians and hide from each other behind the trees and make our guns and bows and arrows out of the branches and sticks that we would find on the floor. We used to have this other game, and I'm sure you know about it. Whenever that somebody might be doing some construction or doing something, there'd be a mound of dirt. And it's on that mound of dirt that we would play King of the Mountain. Now, moms and dads weren't real thrilled about it when we came home covered in dirt, because part of that game, as you know, is you got to climb that mound of dirt. And when you got to the top, you'd be able to yell, "I'm King of the Mountain." But by the time you got mountain out, there'd be another kid pushing you down the mountain. You'd go rolling down the dirt and then try to crawl back up so that you could be King of the Mountain too. You just had to keep working at it. Well, this morning we're going to think about this King of the Mountain, and the King of the Mountain in the story this morning is Zacchaeus. Zacchaeus isn't your ordinary tax collector. If you caught it, he's the chief tax collector in Jericho. He was the one that probably oversaw many of the others. He was maybe the most affluent and influential man in Jericho. He had climbed his way to the top. And he had taken, and because of his wealth, was able to take and put himself in a place in society where, to some extent, some might have admired him, others might have tried to avoid him. He is a man of great wealth. Now, he hears that Jesus is coming to take and visit. And as the song says, as we heard in the scripture, Zacchaeus was a wee little man. No one really knows how short he really was, but consider it that it's enough of a stature issue that it's mentioned. He hears Jesus is coming, and he wants to see Jesus. You ever been in that situation? You just want to see a celebrity, see them. You just want to be able to say, "Yeah, I saw." Now, I'm going to test Diane's memory. I think she remembers this. It was around our 10th anniversary, I guess. We were in Boston. We had gone to this Anthony's Pier 4 for our anniversary dinner. And as we were leaving to come home, we were trying to get on the ramp to take and catch the expressway to go home, and it was blocked. And it was a ramp that goes into, I want to say, the Callahan Tunnel. And it was blocked. We just kind of got there and we were stuck. And we waited. Finally, there were people getting out of the car and kind of walking up the ramp a little bit. And as I did, someone said, "Yeah, it's the president. He's coming through." And sure enough, I mean, there's no traffic on the expressway. All of a sudden, there's a helicopter. All of a sudden, here come the motorcade. And yeah, for some moment, I caught a glimpse of the president's car. Don't know which one it was, but I'm sure I saw the president in his car. I can claim that. It's closest I'll ever get to a president. Zacchaeus wanted to see Jesus. Now, this is a little different, because if you think about it, most of the time the people who are seeking Jesus want to be healed. They're calling to him, "Jesus, save me. Jesus, come, heal me." There are people who are going through the crowds just to possibly get a touch of his cloak. There are people cutting through roofs of houses to lower their friend to Jesus. All Zacchaeus wants to do this day is just see him. He's figured out where Jesus is coming. He's gone to the side of the road, and being a short guy, all of a sudden there's people that probably get in front of him and he can't see a thing. So he climbs a tree. He gets up in its branches, and there he is, just as he is in life, above everybody else, looking down at them. In that tree, it's almost a perfect picture of him being king of the mountain, top of everybody. Jesus comes by. Now, Jesus calls out to Zacchaeus. And I kind of thought about that, and I realized, God, Jesus knows us all. But I'm wondering if, to some extent, as they're walking into Jericho, that somebody might have shared with Jesus, there's this chief tax collector. He's a really short guy, but he's got all this wealth. He's just taken and climbed to his position over other people to get where he was. And maybe that's a little bit on Jesus' mind as he's walking down the street and he happens to see this guy in a tree. And by looking, you can tell he's not the biggest guy in the world. And so he yells out, "Zacchaeus, Zacchaeus, come down here. Come down here. Because today I'm going to have lunch at your house. Zacchaeus, come down." And in a way, what Jesus is doing is he's leveling the playing field. "Zacchaeus, I'm not going to talk to you up in a tree. We're not going to have this conversation. You need to come down. You need to come down. And you know what? We're going to have a conversation around a table at your house." People are scoffing, as they often do, because of who Jesus is choosing to have and share a meal with. This chief tax collector, Jesus is going to spend time with him. Jesus, bad choice. But something happens around that table. Something happens, and the scripture, it kind of just glosses right from that fact that they're going to the house to all of a sudden the declaration of Zacchaeus. I think those declarations come after the meal when they're wrapping up. Something happened in that conversation around that table that transformed, that changed, that made a difference in Zacchaeus' life. Think about what he's just vowed. He's vowed to give up half of his possessions and give it to the poor. That's pretty significant. But if you're a rich guy, if each of us had $10 million and we gave $5 million away, we'd still be pretty rich. So, okay. But he's made another vow that if he's cheated anybody, if he's harmed anybody, he's going to give that person or that family four times what he may have taken from them. These vows that Zacchaeus made is changing the game. He may go from being one of the most affluent people in Jericho to almost being one of the poorest if he makes good on these vows. Think about that for a minute. How many of us would take and make that kind of 180-degree turn in our lives? But something happened around that table. So much for, so that Jesus recognizes that change in Zacchaeus and says that today salvation has come to this house. Salvation. I think about that table. And I think about that the conversation and how that must have worked itself around. You see, whatever it was that came and that saved that house, that saved Zacchaeus, his family, happened around the table. It never would have happened with Jesus talking to him in a tree. It had to happen around the table, face to face, heart to heart. And maybe that's the prescription that we need to be taking and listening to in today's world. As I thought about it, a lot of what's happening in our world that we listen to and see is stuff that's happening with people shouting from tree to tree, right? They're taking and trying to yell over one another. They're trying to take and say, listen, here's what has to happen. And we get so clogged up in all of the noise that we just want to turn it away. How different things would be that instead of yelling and arguing from tree to tree, there was conversation around the table. And I think it's true not only in our greater society, but it's even true in our own lives. We work hard to try to take and whatever power and authority we may have, we try to take and make our voices at times a little bit louder, a little bit stronger, a little bit more stern, so that we can continue to have that power and authority in pushing people down. We want to be the king of the mountain. And Jesus says, no, let's go around and sit around the table and let's just talk. Let's take and work harder to understand than we do to be understood. Let's take and spend a little bit more time listening than we are talking. To me, that's the power of a table. The power of sharing time with one another. To see the other's point of view. To take and sometimes even spend some time looking at ourselves. How did we get to where we are? How did we get to this situation? Is what I'm doing making things better, or is it just making things worse? But around the table, there's a civility that I think that comes. Jesus, as we've been talking over the past few weeks, did a lot of ministry, taking and coming and sitting and being with others around a table at a meal. And I think it's a good thing for us to consider this day. And the challenge may be, who is it that you need to sit and ask, let's go to lunch? Maybe there's somebody, you know, I just need to know more. I need to understand why we have this difference. And let's do it over lunch. Maybe you have a relationship that's strained. Go to lunch. Now, I know that it's going in your head right now is like, well, yeah, that's all well sound good, but we're in the middle of this COVID thing. Going to lunch really isn't an option. Really? Because last I checked, you can sit at a table and still be distanced apart from one another. Last I checked, we're going to have some beautiful days this week. And you know what? As I've done with a couple of people, grab a sandwich and a lawn chair and go and just sit and have a conversation under a tree. Take and pick up your phone and just call someone and said, I want to think about you today. I don't want to yell. I don't want to scream. I want to just have a conversation. Zacchaeus' life was taken and transformed, changed for eternity because Jesus invited him to sit at a table. Who do you need to invite to your table? Let's pray. Oh God, at times we just work really hard to be at times the loudest voice in the room. Sometimes, oh God, we want to push people aside so that we can make it to the top and proclaim that we are the king. And yet, God, that doesn't really work very often. Help us, each and every one of us, oh God, to take and listen, to try to understand, to try and find that place where we can bring our differences together. And while we may not be able to take and smooth everything out, that we're not going to agree on some things, but what we can do is figure out how to live civilly with one another, to embrace one another in love and compassion, to offer forgiveness where it's needed, to take and sacrifice ourselves if that's what's needed, to bring some peace, to bring some understanding, to do it all to the glory of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. As we come to our time of prayers, I've taken and invited people to share bright spots. And I need to take and share with you a bright spot. Now, when my phone goes off at like 7:15 on a Sunday morning, I get a little concerned. Quite often, if it could be my kids, so I'm going to go look. And when it comes from a parishioner, I'm usually a little nervous. But I got to read this one to you. It's from Terry Neese. I won't be there this morning. We've been up all night. Wanted to let you know that Richard's transplant surgery took place in the wee hours of this morning. Devin actually just texted that they are closing. God is with us. And if you don't have a bright spot, this would be a good one. I won't be there this morning. We've been up all night. And here's the other thing that's pretty cool. This is a bright spot of celebration, right? Richard, if you're not aware, has been sick for, I want to say, close to a year. Has been back and forth, out of state, getting treatment, waiting for a transplant. And this morning, it happened. But here's the other part of this that I think says a lot about who we are. I would also like to ask prayers for the donor and their family. If it wasn't for the loss of their life, Richard wouldn't be given one. Bright spot. So, in a moment, we certainly will be praying both for Richard and a full recovery, but also for that donor. There's no greater love, we're told, than to give up a life for a friend. And this donor, on whatever circumstances, gave life to give life. So we certainly rejoice in that. The other bright spot is not wanting to sit with the rest of us in the congregation and breaking the rules of wandering around at certain times. You have to take and allow that on Don Neff's birthday. So we wish Don over in the parlor.
Happy birthday to me.
Yes, yes. So we certainly wish Don a happy birthday as he celebrates with us this morning. So let us come to a time of prayer. Oh God, we certainly do celebrate, and sometimes, oh God, we forget to take and rejoice with you in those moments, and so we certainly do give thanks to that Don has chosen to celebrate his birthday, and just ask that it be filled with blessings and with joy throughout the day. We also celebrate with Devin and Terry and all of the Williams niece family this day, is that we just pray, oh God, that the surgery for Richard is in fact life-giving and the beginning of fulfilling his life and getting back to being able to do so many of the things that he longs to do. We give thanks for their faith and trust in you, God, throughout this ordeal, that they never lost hope, never gave up. And so now, God, we just pray for your healing grace to be showered upon them. We also pray, O God, for those who make the choice to be organ donors, to understand that even in death we can give life. And so we pray for that family that have heavy hearts this day. But we pray, O God, that somewhere in the midst of the sorrow there can be a sense of joy that life continues on. And so we just certainly lift them to you. We pray this day for all those who are suffering from ailments of mind, body, or soul. We just pray, oh God, that you bring your healing grace and shower them with strength and comfort. For people who have anxious hearts, peace. For those who are dealing with this virus in so many different ways, either being sick or having lost someone, God, we just pray that somehow they too will be comforted in the midst of all of this. And God, we certainly pray for our own country, oh God, that seems to be feels like it's being torn from side to side. And we just pray, oh God, for somehow the peace would come, a spirit of cooperation, a spirit of unity would come and find its way into all those who are going to be so divisive. We are a united country, not divided. We pray, O God, for you. Send your spirit to us once again. None of us knows what the weeks ahead will be like, but God, we trust and have our faith in you. And God, we pray for your church. We pray, O God, that we continue to be able to shine forth with good news of your Son, Jesus Christ. You put some challenges before us, God, but we even this morning, despite some issues and problems, we're still here. We're still worshiping, God. We're still going to figure out how to take and reach those who need to hear the good news of your Son. And God, we just give thanks for each and every one that watches today. We all come with our own issues, our own problems, our own concerns. Meet each and every one of us where we are today and help us to be stronger in our faith in you and in your Son, Jesus Christ, who while he was with us gave us these words that now we pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen. I do invite you to take and keep, if you haven't printed out the bulletin, at least look at it. And be aware of all the names that we post and have there each week. Pray those names Keep them upon your heart. So that's what we do as a church family. And we'll be working at putting some of those names up onto our church website so that they're available wherever you may be if you have access to our website. Also want to continue to say thank you for your generosity and graciousness and supporting the ministry here at the church. It enables us to do a variety of different things and continue ministry. We may be doing it a little different, but we're still doing it strong. So again, I want to just say thank you. And again, your gifts can be dropped off here at the church, put in the mail, or even done online. So I want to thank you all for your generosity. So let us take and sing together our last hymn, Freely, Freely. It's number 389. For the benediction that we come and leave this morning. Go in my name, Jesus tells us, and because you believe, others will know that Jesus lives. So let us go forth and live out Jesus in all that we say and all that we do, and we bring his peace to the world in which we live. Go in Christ's holy name. Amen.
Amen.